Ladies and gentlemen, Two Tone Sports here. I feel like being a nice guy today. I'm going to give you PFF's mock draft for free. Why? Because I pay for it and I don't want you to. That's what this channel is going to be about. I will take the hit and I'll give you all the information you guys need. So people like PFF do not get your money. So we're going to kick this off. We have a couple days left to the NFL mock draft. Once again, I'm Two Tone Sports. I will be live the entire NFL mock draft here on YouTube. I will be on PFF. I will have the mock draft live draft up on the other screen. No, I cannot broadcast it, unfortunately. But here we are. Let's dive into PFF's mock draft, if I can find my mouse. So, number one, we got Bryce Young from Alabama going to the Carolina Panthers. Guys, this is what they traded up for. This is kind of known at this point. Young is the consensus best quarterback in this draft. And per Benjamin Robinson's Grinding the Mocks app, is also projected to be the first player selected. He finished as a top 10 graded quarterback in back-to-back years, despite playing the uber-tough SEC conference and losing multiple starters to the NFL from 21 to 22. Guys, this is pretty much a lock. He canceled a good amount of his pre-draft visits. His odds plummeted to minus 1,000 to go first overall. I don't know what they are right now. I didn't look today. But I think it's fair to assume that Bryce Young is going to go first overall. Sorry, a little background here. I'm doing this early in the morning. My next 2-3 videos, you may see me in the same outfit. Why? Because by the time you guys are watching this video, I will be in Amsterdam. All right, I'm going to take a little break. I'm going to still be dropping the videos. They're going to be pre-recorded. But I will be in Amsterdam. And I will be back and be live for the draft. Just, you know, need a little refreshing, taking a little time off work. So, here we go. Number two. Houston Texans go CJ Stroud. Now, this is kind of up in the air, I got to be honest. After a lot of early steam for Stroud to go number one overall, following the Panthers trading up with the Bears, Stroud's stock has fallen back down to earth. While there are reasons for concern with his ability to produce outside of structure, and the context of his elite supporting cast always complicating his evaluation. He was charted as accurate on 68.2% of passes thrown over the past two seasons. That is second in the FBS. Sorry, I just got out of the shower. My hair is out of control. It's not doing anything I want. CJ Stroud going number two here to the Texans. There's a lot of buzz of Will Anderson actually going here. I don't know if it's a smokescreen yet. I know as of last night when I looked, I'm just going to pull FanDuel up just to get some references here. But I know as of last night when I looked, CJ Stroud was not the favorite to go number two. I can tell you, as of right now, Bryce Young is minus 1,200 to go number one. Plus 200 to go at number two is Will Anderson. And CJ Stroud is plus 250, along with Will Levis. I don't think Levis is going over CJ Stroud. Let me put that out here. But also, to put in a little perspective here, Will Anderson and CJ Stroud are plus 250, along with Anthony Richardson to go three. So let me see if I can get this on the camera. I don't know if you guys can see this. I'm trying, but there is the live odds as of right now, which is April 19th is where I'm recording this video. So that's how I think CJ Stroud's still going to go second. I think it's a little bit of a smokescreen trying to get some people to trade up. So here we are, Las Vegas Raiders trading to number three to get Anthony Richardson. I really like this. Raiders are currently in a division with Patrick Mahomes and Justin Herbert, which means they need a quarterback of that caliber to compete in the long term. As PFF's, whatever, one of PFF's guys, Richardson has the goods to develop once he hits the NFL and become an elite quarterback based on his physical tools. Going to a team where he can sit a year behind Jimmy G and be mentored, similar to Trey Lance, would be a good landing spot. I really would love to see Anthony Richardson here. I would love to see Richardson on the Colts just because that coaching staff is nasty. I don't like Josh McDaniels, I gotta be honest. But if you're gonna sit him behind Jimmy G and have him learn from Jimmy G, that's a smart move. It's a smart move. I don't know what they're giving up to get number three here. I wish, you know, you can tell us that, but whatever. Now we got Indianapolis Colts going QB Will Levis. First four picks in the draft are QB. I don't know if that's going to happen. Honestly, I think Arizona could stay at three and take Anderson, but we'll think about it. Will Levis seems like the quarterback at the center of the widest range of opinions in the public sphere. But the Colts desperately need to find a franchise signal caller and can't afford to wait another year for that to happen. Given the surplus value of taking a quarterback over a non-quarterback in this spot, Levis makes the most sense for the Colts and gives new head coach Shane Steichen another big-armed passer similar to what he had in Los Angeles with Justin Herbert. Interesting. And this is a video they put out. So what does that mean? Now this means Seattle falls and gets Will Anderson. Seattle's not falling. Will Anderson's falling to Seattle. Anderson seems like this year's prospect that was so good so early on at the college level that we've begun to have hype fatigue over analyzing every little aspect of his profile, while there are reportedly teams with concerns about how exactly to deploy Anderson. A good organization should be able to figure it out. I mean, really? I don't think there's much concern here. I got to be honest. He's absolutely, in my eyes, he's top three talent. Top three talent. Anderson ranks 14 in pressure rate on true pass sets in 22.9 among edge defenders in 22. And he continued high level of success, all right, through multiple years, actually. So he's proven a lot in college. He's got the size, he's got the speed, he's got all of it. Really, in the next level, all these teams are really gonna have to do is help him polish his game. That's the whole purpose of Anderson in the next level, is polish his game. He's got everything. Let's just see if we can put it together even more. And this would be a steal for the Seattle Seahawks. This is a good trade back for the Cardinals. We'll get there in a second. Detroit Lions going Jalen Carter. Off the field concerns, bad pro day, looked out of shape. I mean, come on. But over the past two seasons, among FBS interior defenders, Carter ranks fifth in pass rush win rate on true pass sets with 23.2 and fourth in pressure rate percentage, 19.6. The Lions added two starting caliber outside corners in free agency. So here they address arguably the biggest remaining weakness. Yeah, I agree with this. I'm also not sold that they don't go corner here. I know they added two. I know they shipped off Okuda, but I'm not sold. I'm totally not sold that they're not going to go corner here. The value is Jalen Carter for sure, but once again, we shall see. So, here we are. Cardinals trading back, getting Christian Gonzalez. Cardinals lost their top quarterback, Byron Murphy, this offseason and didn't do anything to replace him. Gonzalez has all the physical tools to be a great corner in the league and would fit very well with new head coach Jonathan Gannon's zone-heavy scheme that he'll likely employ in Arizona. Gannon also comes from teams that have drafted quarterbacks early in the draft, with Minnesota with Trey Waynes and Indianapolis with Rakia Sin. I mean, this is kind of simple. They need a corner. They trade back here. They also need an edge, but so don't be shocked if they either go Tyree Wilson here or Christian Gonzalez, whatever they see more as a fit. And also depends on how much and what they get for the trade back. So, wow, there's a lot to write here. Tyree Wilson going to the Atlanta Falcons. I love this kid. All right. Atlanta has overhauled its defense this offseason when they ranked 30th in 22, blah, blah, blah. Atlanta has typically added smaller edge players than the 6'6", 271 pounder in Tyree Wilson, but he offers inside-outside flexibility, and adding a power rusher to a group of more finesse-type players could be smart. You simply cannot be successful against the pass in today's NFL with your edge defenders winning fewer than 15% of pass rush reps. Falcons ranked dead last at 14.7 and pressured QB only on 12.3%. That's brutally bad. Brutally bad. Wilson ranked 17th in true pass rush sets at 29.9 and 16th in pressure percent. He should also be a solid run defender right out of the gate with his massive frame. Once again, he's 6'6". He's got the length. He's got everything there. I love this kid. And honestly, at 8, I think this is a really good pick. I really love this kid. I think this is a smart pick for the Bears, too. Chicago Bears already made the most important move they could this offseason, acquiring true number one receiver, DJ Moore. Free agency, they focus their efforts on improving the defensive front seven. Unless Jalen Carter is still on the board, the Bears should pivot back to offense, reunite Fields with Paris Johnson, who had a 4.4 pressure rate on true pass sets. Good for 20th. That's crazy. It being his first year as a starting left tackle, Johnson played right tackle, versatile, so that's huge. That's why I think he's going to be the first. He's probably going to be the first lineman off the board. And you're going to see Peter Skoronski shortly after. But whatever. The Bears also deploy the popularized outside zone-based rushing attack. And Johnson's 85.5 run blocking grade on outside zone runs in 22 ranked 6th among FBS tackles. The dude is a stud. He's going to be solid. He's going to come in and start immediately. There's going to be no question about it. And the reason he's going to be the first lineman off the board, there's no question on whether he could play tackle or not. All right. The next name on this list going to the Eagles is the reason I say that. Peter Skoronski, his length is in question, everything like that. His versatility is off the charts, though. All right. The tough part with this selection in an analytics mock is that it relies on Skoronski being able to play tackle at the next level. In his final season at Northwestern, the short-armed Skoronski allowed 1.3 quarterback pressure rate, the third best mark in the FBS, going against quality Big Ten edge defenders. If Skoronski cannot hold up as a left tackle at the NFL level, could he perhaps play right guard next to the future Hall of Fame right tackle Lane Johnson and then get a shot to take over his job at right tackle? While the value of a guard in the top 10 is debatable, no longer should right tackles be viewed as significantly less valuable than left. If anything, there is marginal difference between the two positions. I get this pick, but I don't think it's the Eagles' biggest need. I really don't, especially with what's on the board. Don't get me wrong, I get it, but I don't know if I'm going Skoronski here at 10, especially with how this board has fallen. I'm just going to say that. I'm not going to say this is a miserable pick, but it's not. This is not a miserable pick. This is like a C+, but this isn't their biggest need. This is what you see as a C- here. All right. It seems easy to forget because he missed the entire 22 season due to, I believe, a hamstring injury. Blah, blah, blah. His 91.7 PFF grade ranked second at the position. And he led a wide receiver room with two future top 12 picks, Garrett Wilson and Olave. The Titans could use an offensive lineman here. That's what I think the better pick would have been. But with Skronsky and Johnson off the board, Smith Najigba makes sense and adds another body to a wide receiver room that desperately needs more star power. I agree. This is definitely more needed, I would say that. They need a receiver, but more needed, they need offensive tackle. But they went receiver, so they think they can grab one in the second round, is what it is. This is how it's fallen. Skronsky and Johnson are off the board. I don't think there's any issue taking Broderick Jones here, but I could easily be wrong. Houston Texans go Lucas Van Ness. Van Ness snap sample size was fairly small at Iowa, but for a good reason. Iowa typically lets its older players get more run, and the redshirt sophomore will be 21 years old on draft night. When we did see Van Ness, he displayed a lot of power and really impressive bend around the edge for someone who measured 6'5", 272. 22, he's 12th among FBS defenders, pass rush win rate, fourth in pressure percentage. That's crazy. Okay, Houston needs to get after the quarterback more consistently after the team lost, I can't say his name, Ogbonna, whatever, to the Browns in free agency. Van Ness would serve as a capable replacement. Interesting. I like this for a 12 pick. There you go. New York Jets, Broderick Jones, Mekhi Becton, you can't rely on. I'm going to say it every single video until you guys get annoyed by it. Nothing wrong with continuing to invest resources at premium positions. In fact, in many ways, we can argue teams don't do it enough. That's true, especially at quarterback. Jones requires some continued growth at setting his anchor and not succumbing. Okay, and take a second there. Two bull rushes so frequently, but is a remarkable athlete in the space. Only 2.3 pressure rate on true pass sets. That ranks him 10th among FBS tackles. It's a move they need to do, especially if they're going to bring in Rodgers. You can't rely on Becton being healthy and even honestly playing at this point. Patriots are going Devon Witherspoon. There's a hell of a gap here between CB1 and CB2. Witherspoon is regarded as the best man corner in the class. Elite 92.5 coverage grade this past year, which is first in the FBS. Given Bill Belichick's man-heavy scheme, Witherspoon would be a great fit if he falls to 14. Even though the Patriots found a couple of gems in the draft at quarterback last year, they're still missing a true shutdown CB like they have with Gilmore and Jackson. Witherspoon can be that. This is a total Bill Belichick pick. This is total scheme fit. This is and value-wise, this is an A-plus pick for the Patriots. This is huge. This is a great pick. Packers not going with another first-round wide receiver. So, one could certainly argue that Green Bay should take a pass catcher here. They're going to go Nolan Smith at 15, edge defender out of Georgia. But Rashawn Gary tearing his ACL to close out the 22 season, the Packers' pass rush took a major hit. Over the past two seasons, Smith is one of just five Power 5 edge defenders to earn 80-plus grades as a pass rusher and run defender. People do not talk enough about this kid's run defense. 91.3 run defense grade, the top mark in the entire FBS. But everybody is so focused on his pass rush because he's explosive, he's quick, and he's undersized. But the kid can still play in the run defense. This is a high-level pick for the Packers. This is an awesome pick. Awesome pick. I like Nolan Smith. I would like to see him put on a little bit of weight. I don't think it's going to affect his game that much, but he's going to be tough to guard on the edge. He's going to be tough to guard. And he's gonna look awesome in the Packers. Here we are. Commanders are going Joey Porter Jr. Ron Rivera has never taken a cornerback in the first round as head coach of a team, but this year is a great year to do so. Commanders are currently projected to have Benjamin St. Juste and Kendall Fuller starting on the outside, which doesn't really give you a lot of confidence. Getting a true CB1 would be the best pick for them. I totally agree. They need to go corner here. And Joey Porter Jr. at 16 is very good pick. Taking him right before the Steelers, who go Darnell Wright. I agree with this. The Steelers need to go Darnell Wright. They found the franchise QB in Kenny Pickett, but now they need to surround him with pieces to allow him to develop and succeed, especially since they're also heavy running. This is going to help all assets of their offense. This helps Najee. This helps Pickett. This helps Pickens, Freiermuth, everybody. Helps everybody. Taking Darnell Wright, the best remaining offensive lineman on the board, would be a huge boost in that department as he would replace Dan Moore Jr. at left tackle and give Pickett a solid line to throw behind. Now the Giants. The Lions are getting Deontay Banks out of Maryland. This is value, man. This is good. This kid was a beast on the NFL Combine. This is why they didn't go corner in the first pick, because they have 18 and they're going to be fine with any cornerback that falls here. So they traded Jeff Okuda to the Falcons. Now need a new starting cornerback for Aaron Glenn's scheme. Banks is the best corner on the board at this point. Will be a great addition to their secondary. This would probably cause one of Cam Sutton or Emmanuel Mosley to kick inside and play slot, given Banks was primarily outside corner in Maryland. Regardless, Banks' addition would give the Lions their best secondary in a while. They had to move on from Okuda. He honestly wasn't consistent enough. I mean, whatever. They traded him away. They got what they got. They have two first-round picks. You're going to replace him. I like this pick. Value is good here, too. Kid tested off the charts at the Combine, too. Here we are with Tampa doing the right thing. Anton Harrison, one of the best pass blockers in this draft. Bucks recently signed Matt Filer, but he projects more as a guard, especially since they traded away Shaq Mason. Filer played his last two seasons at left guard with the Chargers. Underperformed, to be honest. I'm a Chargers fan. I'm not saying this to talk down on the Bucks. He's not what he used to be. Better than what you had. Well, have, considering you traded Shaq Mason away. So, I get it, but I don't expect elite level out of Filer anymore. So, Tibbin needs to find a tackle opposite of Wirfs. And with Harrison still on the board, this pairing makes sense. This would also allow Wirfs to remain on the right side of the line, giving Harrison played left tackle since he was a true freshman. One of the best pass blocking grades in the draft. I don't like that they don't put that out there. So, solid pick for the Bucks, no matter who they have at QB. Here we are, Seattle Seahawks, Zay Flowers. This is an awesome pick, all right? Seahawks have done well to provide Geno Smith with offensive weapons while building up their offensive line, but they're still lacking a quality third wideout. Zay Flowers is similar to Lockett. That's why I said this is an awesome pick. Similar to Lockett in terms of his frame, but different in the way they operate. While Lockett is notorious for not generating many yards after the catch, Flowers ranked 16th in college football in that category last year, and would give the Seahawks a horizontal element to their offense. Speedy, quick twitch, small frame, but pairing him with Lockett and DK outside gives Geno all the weapons in the world. And you got Big Kenneth in the backfield. Crazy. Crazy. Moving on to my Los Angeles Chargers. Love this pick. This is a home run pick. This is honestly how I want this to fall. I'm explaining why a wide receiver may not be a first round pick anymore. Chargers will likely use the 21st pick to address depth, given they have most of their starting roles filled. They currently have Chris Rumpf as edge 3, and one of Joey Bosa or Khalil Mack will likely be released next season, correct? Due to cap hits. With Murphy still on the board and him fitting the athletic thresholds the Chargers have historically had under general manager Tom Telesco, this would be a good pick for Los Angeles. This is a awesome home run pick for Los Angeles. This is great value, top tier value for the Chargers at this point. Don't know if they're going to go wide receiver in the first round because they just re-signed their speed receiver, Jalen Guyton. Keenan Allen's probably going to be off the roster next year. So the way the roster is looking right now, as of today, you have Mike Williams, Keenan Allen, Josh Palmer, Jalen Guyton, similar guys to what Herbert has had. Don't be shocked if we add maybe a second to later round wide receiver. So don't be shocked with that one. But edge depth is necessary and value is there. Value is there. Manuel Forbes, Mississippi State. Going to the Ravens. This is a Ravens pick, man. Ravens signed Odell. Doesn't completely remove them from the wideout sweepstakes, but it does minimize the need. Boom, boom, boom. Taking Forbes. He improved on his PFF grades every year for the past 3 years. 16th best PFF grade in college football. Baltimore Ravens, that's a good pick. That's a good pick. Maybe a little reach on Forbes, but honestly, he's what's left, and I get it. Minnesota taking Quentin Johnston. This is a really cool pairing, too. I maybe probably want Jordan Addison here over him, but whatever. After releasing Adam Thielen in the offseason, the Vikings need to find their wide receiver opposite of Justin Jefferson. Johnson makes the most sense of the remaining receivers and offers more of a downfield after the catch than Jordan Addison. I agree. Addison's more of the route runner, but that's what you have in Justin Jefferson. Justin Jefferson is really an all-around wide receiver. But if you're going to double him, Quentin Johnson's going to hurt you. So that's why I get this. 8.9 yards after the catch per reception is 10th amongst receivers. This is an awesome pick. I really am a big fan of Quentin Johnson. I don't think he's getting enough love. Brian Branch going to Jacksonville. This is a little slide for him. A little bit of a slide for him. Branch doesn't really have an assigned position. He fits in as a box safety or slot corner at the next level, which is where... Give me a second. I charge my laptop. Which is... where he probably will play. He's just so versatile. Man, I'm messing this whole thing up. Look at this. Can't find the hole, huh?
Normally don't have that issue.
Brian Branch is just versatile. He's going to be all over the place. And it's a great pick for the Jags. If they don't go lineman here, you know, to help out... honestly, just building around Trevor Lawrence. If they don't go lineman here, Brian Branch is the pick. He's way too versatile. Can play all over the place. Coming out of Alabama, too, and Nick Saban defense. I mean, come on. Branch would likely take over from day one. Alabama product also brings the flexibility to move back to safety if necessary. All right. Brian Breece going to the Giants. This is interesting. I haven't seen this yet. Giants could really use a cornerback here to play with in Wink Martindale's blitz-heavy scheme, but because of the run on cornerbacks early in the draft, it doesn't make sense for the G-men to reach on a prospect. Instead, they're taking Breece, who has fallen a bit down the draft boards, but would be a good pickup for general manager Joe Schoen and company. Or Schoen, whatever. They have their starters filled out for this season, but Leonard Williams is a free agent after this season, and there's no succession plan currently in place. This is a safety pick. This is an absolute safety pick. And honestly, these two, if you can bring back Leonard Williams and keep Brian Breece, assuming he's healthy, This could be nasty pairing and cause a lot of issues for teams. This is a nasty pairing. I think he's a safer pick than Calvin Kanci. Calvin Kanci is either a home run or a kind of bust pick in my eyes. I think Brian Breese is a more of a safer pick at that position at this point. Dallas Cowboys going. Kalijah Kanci. I don't know why I keep saying Calvin. Kalijah Kanci. The Cowboys have invested a lot in their edge room, but are still lacking in the pass rush department from the interior. Kanci is widely considered the second best pass rushing D tackle outside of Jalen Carter. Given that Dan Quinn stunts more than any defensive coordinator in the NFL, having an athletic defensive tackle like Kanci would wreak havoc for offensive lines. Him, Micah Parsons, nasty line. It's a nasty line. This is a really good pick for Dallas. So I'm really interested in where D-Hop goes, to be honest with you. Buffalo Bills getting kind of crazy value here. The Bills need to add more weapons around Josh Allen and find another reliable pass catcher for him to throw to. Gabe Davis was expected to take that next step in 22, but did not. While some mocks want the Bills to replace Tremaine Edmonds and take a linebacker, it's just not of value at this point. They go Jordan Addison, great route running, great hands, just another weapon for Josh Allen. He's going to be their wide receiver two behind Diggs there. Gabe Davis is going to go back to the home run guy. And I like this pick a lot. I really like this pick for the Bengals too. Duane Jones. All right. Bengals making it a priority for the second straight offseason to upgrade their offensive line. Signing Orlando Brown. Here they continue to add the unit by mammoth of the lineman, Duane Jones. I want to say he's like 6'7". I mean, he's going to play right tackle where he played at Ohio State. This is also assuming Jonah Williams is traded at some point in the offseason. Yeah, guys, he wants out. He requested a trade. This would pretty much shore up the safety of that position. So this is just a smart pick and what honestly what they need to do. New Orleans Saints going Mazi Smith. Saints lost a ton of talent in the interior of their defense. Mazi Smith would be a great fit for them as a run defending tackle who also has the athleticism to develop into a reliable pass rusher. Love this. Do not count out Mickey Loomis from trading up in the first round either. Mazi Smith is a good pick here. Probably right around where he should go. He should go late first, maybe early second. But this is a solid pick for that team. So, boom. Here we have some little run on defensive players to end out this first round. You got the Philadelphia Eagles taking Adebawore at a Northwestern. Eagles need to find their heir apparent to Fletcher Cox. Adebawore would fit in well with the current defensive line. Adebawore is sort of a tweener, but we project that he'll fit in better inside rather than outside. Okay. Eagles have poured into their edge defender room the past couple years. Adebawore under the premise of him kicking inside. This is a good depth pick. This is a good value pick. I don't, like I said, I don't like the Peter Skoronski pick in the beginning, but this I understand because of the depth. Maybe you can get better value at this position right now, but yeah. Chiefs going, Felix Nduke-Uzomah. Instead of Adebawore, I probably would rather want to see, like, BJ Ojulari for them. For the Eagles, but who am I? Chiefs going, Felix Nduke-Uzomah out of Kansas State. Coming off Super Bowl, needed to find a tackle and receiver. And Mecole Hardman leaving. However, they can use another edge rusher behind Karlaftis. Given that the drop-off in finding starting edge rusher in round one versus other rounds is significant, getting one with a top 50 pick is important. Allow Chiefs to build depth at the position. They're going to go Felix Nduke-Uzomah or McDonald or Ojulari. I just think the value is there and it's the right pick. Maybe a little reach of Jalin Hyatt here. Trying to think if any other receivers are still out there, but That's really how this is going to fall. This is an analytical mock draft, so it's normal. It's a little bit different than normal. But, guys, once again, this is PFF's 2023 NFL mock draft. Please don't pay for them. They're annoying. I use them to do mock drafts, so that's literally why. But here we are. Four QBs go off the board in the first. Anderson slides down 5 in Seattle. Once again, guys, Two Tone Sports here. As always, thank you for watching.